Today we're going to talk about derivatives of trig functions. In other words, the slope on the tangent line for the cosine function and for the sine function. We're going to use the definition of derivative to derive the shorthand formulas for the derivatives of sine and cosine. Because the definition of derivative has limits in it, we're going to need to use some additional facts that we haven't seen before that we're going to just derive for ourselves. So let's get started. Here are some things we're going to need. Remember these trig identities called addition formulas. If I take the cosine of the sum of two numbers, a plus b, I get the cosine of a, cosine of b, minus sine of a, sine of b. This formula is true no matter what a and b I use. It's just something that's true about cosine and sine functions. And of course, there's a similar identity for the sine of a plus b. We're also going to need the definition of derivative. For starters, we're going to be looking at the cosine function. If we do this process for the cosine function, our f is going to be cosine. So we're going to have cosine of x plus h. And you can see that this formula is going to come in handy because our a will be x and our b will be h. What will happen while we're taking derivatives is that we're going to encounter this limit. So let's calculate what this limit is. It's a different type of argument than we've done before for limits. Suppose this is the unit circle. If h is getting plugged into the sine, that means I should interpret it geometrically as an angle. So I'm drawing a small, tiny little acute angle of h. As you can see over here on the vertical side of the triangle, as this angle gets really, really small, the height of the vertical side on the triangle is approximately equal to the length of the arc on the side of the unit circle. And as h gets smaller and smaller, the vertical side of the triangle and the length on the arc of the unit circle, they're more and more similar as h goes to zero. A blown up version of this h angle, we're zoomed into the picture. As h goes to zero, as that angle gets smaller and smaller, the length of the vertical side and the length of the arc of this circle approach each other. So let's label the arc with L. L is just a fraction of the whole circle. Whatever fraction L is over the circumference of the circle, which here is 2 pi times the radius, which is 1, so I'm not going to write the radius. This ratio is equal to the ratio of the h angle to the total angles in a circle, which is 2 pi or 360 degrees. This tells us that L is approximately equal to h. Let's summarize what we found. If h is approximately equal to zero, the value of the angle will approximately be equal to the value of the vertical side. Now remember, this whole derivation was on a unit circle, so I'm assuming that the hypotenuse is 1 here. Finally, we're ready to go with this limit. If I take the sine on this triangle, I'll get opposite, which is h, divided by hypotenuse, which is 1. See, the h's are canceling, and our final answer is 1. The limit as h goes to 0 of sine of h over h is equal to 1. Keep that in mind. We're going to use it later. Here's another limit we're going to need. The limit as h goes to 0 of cosine of h minus 1, all divided by h. Seems kind of random, but it will make sense once we're taking the derivative of cosine. So let's figure out what it is in advance. We're going to take advantage of a result that we had from class last time. We started with the function square root of x, and the problem was to find the equation of the tangent line at x equals 1. If we write the function in the format x to the half power, then we can calculate the derivative using the power rule that we derived in class as a half x to the negative half, and then we get 1 over 2 square root of x. Now at x equals 1, plugging in x equals 1 into this derivative formula, the slope of this line is a half. Our equation will be y is equal to mx plus b, and we just figured out that that m value is a half. What's the correct b value? At this point, the xy coordinates here are 1, 1. Using that 1, 1 has to lie on this tangent line, we're getting that our b value must be a half. Now comes the crucial part. If we keep our x values very close to x equals 1, the height on the square root function is approximately equal to the height on the tangent line. That's because the tangent line touches at the single point and gets really close to the square root function as long as your x's are really close to 1. Of course, over here, the tangent line and the square root are kind of far away. If x is very close to 1, then the height on the square root function is going to be approximately equal to the height on the tangent line function. Now, this is the crucial result that we're going to need in order to figure out this limit up here. This is also a preview to a topic we're going to do a bit more later called linearization. The square root function is linearized by the tangent function. They're approximately equal as long as you stay really close to the point of contact, which here is x equals 1. So here's our result that we're going to keep in mind on the side. And finally, we can get back to our unit circle. Since h is getting plugged into the cosine function, I should interpret h like a very small angle. Since h is approaching 0, it's going to be pretty small. Now, our previous result told us that if h is very small, then the vertical side on this triangle is approximately h. Now, if the hypotenuse is 1 and the vertical side is h, then using the Pythagorean theorem, the horizontal side will be the square root of 1 minus h squared. Okay, finally, let's get back to our question. Cosine of h up here will be adjacent side, 1 minus h squared, divided by hypotenuse, which is 1. Let's just copy down the rest of the expression, minus 1 over h. Now we're going to use our second result down here. If h approaches 0, then the stuff getting plugged into the square root is getting very close to 1. So if the stuff getting plugged into the square root is approximately equal to 1, then we can replace the square root with a half x plus a half. So I'm going to replace the square root with half times 1 minus h squared plus a half. Copy down the rest of the expression, the minus 1 and the whole thing divided by h. A half plus a half minus 1 adds up to 0. Using my limit laws, I can pull this half out of the limit. Now I can cancel. So finally I get just the limit as h goes to 0 of h. Our final answer here is 0. This limit that we're looking for is equal to 0. Let's summarize. A couple of slides ago we showed that the limit as h goes to 0, sine of h over h, is equal to 1. And on the previous slide, we showed that the limit as h goes to 0, cosine of h, minus 1 over h, that one is equal to 0. Okay, finally, we're going to use these two limits that we have, and we're going to take the derivative of the cosine function using the limit definition of derivative, and these results are going to come in handy. So you can see that I've started the calculation. Using the cosine of x plus h minus the cosine of x all divided by h, that's going to give me the slope of a secant line on the cosine function. Taking the limit as h goes to 0 will give me the slope of the tangent line or the derivative. Because there's no way to simplify this upper expression by, say, factoring or doing any of the usual algebraic methods, we're forced to use this addition formula from the top here. Our a is x and our b is h. Now let's collect terms. We're looking for terms that have common expressions. The first term has a cosine of x in it, and the last term has a cosine of x in it. So let's bring those together by saying cosine of x times the quantity cosine of h minus 1, and then we have the remaining quantity minus sine x sine h, all divided by h. I hope you can see that there's some magic happening here. Inside here, I'm getting cosine of h minus 1 divided by h. That should look familiar. Over in the other piece, I'm getting sine of h divided by h. So let's use our limit laws to separate the parts. Now you can see why we spent so much time trying to figure out what this random limit is, because while we're doing the derivative of cosine, this limit appears, and so does this one. Now using our previous work, we know that this limit approaches 0, and this limit approaches 1. What about these other terms? What happens to the cosine of x if h approaches 0? Notice that there's no h's in here. If h is equal to 0.1, then we get cosine of x. If h is equal to 1/100, we get cosine of x. Any value for h, we will still get cosine of x. Every single h value gives us the same value. So the value of this limit is just cosine of x, because there's no h's in there, so this quantity couldn't possibly change as h's change, so it just stays itself. Same thing over here. There's no h's, it's just sine of x. H can go to 0 all day, sine of x will stay sine of x. The derivative of the cosine function is negative sine after we add this stuff up. Remember, we had these rules for how the graph of a function relates to the graph of the derivative. If f of x is strictly increasing, then f prime of x is positive. If f of x is strictly decreasing, then f prime of x is negative. Here's the cosine function, and what we found is that the derivative of cosine is equal to negative sine. So let's graph the negative sine function. Looking at the cosine function, between 0 and pi, the cosine function is decreasing. If a function is decreasing, all of its slopes are negative. Then what should its derivative do? Down here on the negative sine function, everything is negative, representing that the cosine has negative slopes corresponding to negative. negative heights on the negative sine function. So if the original function is decreasing, the derivative function is negative. If the original function is increasing, then the derivative is positive. And we can follow this logic through the whole graph. Cosine is decreasing where negative sine is negative, and cosine is increasing where negative sine is positive. Now let's take the derivative of the sine function using our sine trig identity up here, setting a equal to x and b equal to h, just like the last one. We get this expression. Now we can factor out in a similar way that we did before. There's a sine of x that appears in the first quantity, and there's a sine of x that appears in the last quantity. So let's factor that out. And using our limit laws to separate the parts, now when we're taking the limit, we did all this work in order to show that this one goes to 0 and this one goes to 1. So our final answer is sine of x times 0 plus cosine of x times 1, adding this up, and we get cosine. So what we found out here is that the derivative of sine is cosine. Now thinking about this graphically, it's a bit different than the other one we did. Here sine is the original function, and the derivative of the sine function is cosine. We can see similar types of trends. As the original function is increasing, that's from 0 to pi over 2, its derivative is positive. So if the sine function is increasing, the cosine function is positive. And if the sine function is decreasing, that's from pi over 2 to 3 pi over 2, in that region, the cosine is negative. And we can keep going. If the sine graph is increasing, then the cosine graph is positive. If the sine graph is decreasing, then the cosine graph is negative. So there you go. Now you know the derivatives of some of our favorite trig functions. Keep these derivations that we did in mind. I do expect that you will know them. In order to move on to more complicated topics, what we're going to be doing is just using the shorthand formulas after some point. I still expect that you know where the formulas came from, so make sure you know these derivations.